Today we gotta talk about Rise of the Ronin because a part of me feels like it's been thrown to the side ever since it was released. Between massive games like Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, Dragon's Dogma 2, and Stellar Blade, I haven't heard as many people talking about Ronin. With this being the newest combat-focused child from Team Ninja, it's crazy to think that some people might not even give it a fair chance. With the internet talking about how it looks like a PS3 game and clowning it for running at 30 frames per second.
This is just ridiculous, I think, for a game in 2024 that's $70. And so if it has all those issues and it still is running and looks like a PS3 game, it's really hard to figure out why this game is worth $70.
But you know what? I had to put down my playthrough of Rebirth for just a moment to check this out for myself and see what's really going on with Rise of the Ronin. Because if there's one thing I know about the homies at Koei Tecmo and Team Ninja, they know how to cook up some of the best action games out there. So let's dig in and see what it's all about. The story takes place in the Bakumatsu era of Japan, nearing the final years of the Tokugawa shogunate. It's a time right before the modern government of Japan began. But of course, there has to be some crazy shit going down, including Westerners entering Japan to spread that good old democracy. In the middle of all this, we follow the story of two samurais who are bound together by fate. They call this kind of thing blade twins, who train together, fight together, and become one powerful force through two separate bodies. And because of that, you create not one, but two characters that you can swap between in the beginning. And not long after, they do make you choose between which one you want to play as through the rest of the game. And that's a really important choice too, which you find out really early on in the plot. You start off with a mission breaking into a British ship, and that ends with tragedy as a samurai with a blue mask gets in your way, basically separating you from your blade twin. Even after returning home, you end up fighting the master who trained both you and your twin, ending with your eventual victory. From this point on, you officially become a Ronin, aka a samurai with no master. Your main goal is to uncover the mystery behind the events that took place on that ship and defeat whoever you need to along the way. And the entire rest of the game is filled with plenty of characters, dialogue choices, and events that draw connections from real life history. Funny enough, I talked about Like a Dragon Ishin not too long ago, and the two of these games basically take place around the same time period. With the main difference being that Ronin is a lot more hardcore and down to earth with how they do the storytelling. But if you want a similar story that's a little more goofy, then definitely check out Ishin. As you work your way through the story, there's a ton of variety in how things can play out. First off being the bonds you can make with different characters. It kind of explains itself where doing quests with people, spending time with them, and buying them gifts will raise the bond that you have. And that bond ends up being very important if you want to unlock rewards that only come from those characters. That can be a wide range of things too, so make sure that you pay attention to each person's bond and focus on what you want the most. You gotta be careful though, because there's moments where you can totally ruin the chance of a bond between you and someone else. Some bonds can be skipped if you choose options like killing someone or picking certain factions. I actually love the idea of this because it feels like your actions make a big difference within the world. And that's especially true when you start getting into parts of the story that deal with warring factions. The story shifts based on the groups that you choose to help out and can lead to some really dire consequences later on. I'm not gonna get too deep into that, but remember that some trophies or rewards might be locked behind those choices. After a while, you get the option of going back and changing the course of events, so don't worry too much about if you made a bad choice. If you're a fan of that kind of choice and world building, I know you'll have a blast trying out the different possibilities. But on the other hand, if there was one thing I have to say that I like the least, it's probably the story. For anyone out there who loves Japanese history, there's definitely a lot of references and characters that pay a lot of respect to the time period. But despite all the deep characters and the faction building, it all just felt a bit
boring.
Not gonna lie, the same way I fell asleep in history classes in high school, I really wasn't getting pulled in by this. There is a lot of stuff going on within here, and sometimes it gets hella confusing. People you meet and become friends with in one quest will end up being the enemy by the next one. But at the same time, they aren't the enemy. It's something about what they did with these characters and factions that just got a bit hard to keep up with. And after a while, I completely forgot who half the people I met even were. There's over 45 characters you can create bonds with here, and for the entire game to be about 40 hours long, there is no way you'll come out of this remembering everyone by name. I gotta say that at first, I was a little upset when I looked at the entire map. Compared to most other open world games, this is very small. I felt like walking from one end to the other would take no time at all, especially if you're riding your horse to do it. But what I didn't realize was that the map that you see from the beginning is only the map for Chapter 1. And I kinda had that same thought about Ghost of Tsushima when it first released. You know how they give you this open area to do missions in for the first few hours, and then after you defeat the big boss right at the top, you realize that that was only the beginning. Now, it didn't hit nearly as hard here because there's not really a way to see that there's more to explore until they take you to a whole new place. But I'm just glad this didn't end up being the whole thing because I damn near explored it all within the first 12 hours. One thing I gotta say that sucks is that the voice acting here is a little weak.
Why? You could go toe to toe with Kogoro Katsura or Ryoma Sakamoto. Those names must have reached your ears, I'm sure.
I normally don't care about that sort of thing, but playing with the English dub, you can tell that it's not top quality. You might want to play this with the Japanese voices if it ends up bothering you, because some of these lines come out terribly.
What do you say? A simple job for a mighty warrior like yourself, no?
I can't tell if the voice cast just weren't trained properly or if they were trying to go for certain accents. There's a lot of characters that are Japanese as well as British, so they maybe were trying to aim for something more authentic? Either way, I wouldn't expect too much in terms of voice talents here. But ever since this game came out, the only thing I've been hearing from people is comparisons between this and Ghost of Tsushima. And obviously, after playing for a few hours, you can definitely tell why. First off, the era is similar, and the aesthetics are similar, and hell, even the combat is similar in a few places. But I wouldn't say that it's that close to being the same kind of game, though. One thing I kept hearing about Ronin is that it looks like a PS3 game, and I wouldn't even say all that. Now, if you're comparing it to Tsushima, then yeah, I wouldn't even say it comes close to looking as good. The colors and the lighting here tend to be more dull, and even in missions where they want you to take pictures, it always looks bland. But in Ghost of Tsushima, one of the best features was the photo mode. And that's because of how beautiful things look damn near everywhere you went. And hey, I don't usually care for photo modes, and even I was getting creative with it because it was just straight up beautiful. So as much as I would say that Ronin is close to Tsushima in a few ways, I just can't put them in the same exact category. Expecting these games to be on the same level would probably make Ronin look a lot worse, and that might be a big reason why people turned away from it. But despite all that, when you start digging deeper into the weapons, the skill trees, and all of the fighting mechanics, that's where Ronin starts to flourish. The combat system feels like it's closer to the Neo series, and that makes a lot of sense with Team Ninja being behind them both. You can even draw connections to their other games like Wolong and Ninja Gaiden. They're really good at making games with that extra bit of difficulty, but plenty of unique ways to handle each fight. Like for me, I'm not the best at getting my parries on time, but there were plenty of moments where I still made it through with no problem. Like sometimes when I know that I'm outmatched or at my limit, I'll just pull out a gun and start blasting. I may be out of key, but I ain't out of options. It's that accessibility that makes games like this that much more fun to me. Even when I can't be a master of the blade, I can use my environment to my advantage or take out their forces slowly in secret. But of course, there's a ton of variety in how you upgrade yourself and handle each fight. Even if my parries did suck, I appreciate the idea of having the counter spark system that they have set up. That's basically everything revolving around your key bar and the parrying system. You want to aim for being patient and learning your opponent's patterns just so you don't waste all of your key. But it's a balancing act sometimes between attack, parry, swapping weapons, and cleaning your blade, all while keeping up with your opponent. And there's even more variety that goes into some fights where you can bring up to two other teammates. Just like the beginning where you can swap between you and your blade twin, plenty of characters that you meet can also assist you in battles. And it's a cool strat to make your enemy focus on one person and then swap between each other to throw off their attacks. Using that really helped me out in some fights where it was tougher to predict my enemy's attack pattern. One of the most unique things is that every weapon you can wield has its own set of different stances. The stances make it so your attacks come out differently, even with totally different special moves. But the best part is that there's different strengths and weaknesses for each stance based on the weapon and stance your opponent has. Basically, these red, blue, and gray arrows that pop up. It might not be a huge deal if you're just built different, but it's cool seeing that level of depth going into so many weapons and styles. But the thing is that the stances are not just given to you. There's a lot of them that are locked behind the story, side missions, or completion rewards. And again, that goes back to the Bond stuff. It's the kind of thing that makes you want to explore as much of the world as you can so you can make the most of all the weapons that you want to try out for yourself. Even the skill tree is really diverse and it branches out based on the playstyle you want the most. For me, I focused on skills that gave me better dialogue choices, more weapon damage, and buffs for the handgun since I'm always using it. But things like buffs for the bow and arrow or rifles just never got touched because I wouldn't ever need those. Once you find out exactly what you enjoy about Ronin, finding the right skills gets a lot easier. The best way I can describe my time with Rise of the Ronin is by looking at this meme about Little Caesars. Because the same way that somebody could tell you that Domino's or Papa John's is better doesn't mean that you can't enjoy your Little Caesars in peace. Like yeah, Ghost of Tsushima is gonna look better when you draw up the comparisons, but instead you're better off going into this for what it is. Like I really enjoyed my time with Rise of the Ronin and the hours flew by every time I played it. It became addicting to unlock new regions and fight as many outlaws as I could find. If you're just a little bit interested in trying it, I say go for it and see what you think of it for yourself. The combat alone is what Team Ninja put a lot of time into developing, and my god does it feel fantastic. It's quick, it's challenging, and it gives you so much variety. But hey, maybe you have a different opinion and I would love to hear it. So let me know in the comments what you thought about Rise of the Ronin. Is this really a Ghost of Tsushima clone to you, or is it something else entirely? Subscribe for more videos just like this one, and I'll see you all in the next video.